This morning, if you'd like to turn with us, I want to turn back to the verses there in 2 Corinthians, the second epistle, 2 Corinthians chapter 1. We'll start looking there at verse 3. We endeavored last Sunday to try to bring forth a message, the message of God's daily deliverance. And so upon my heart and mind this morning is still along those thoughts. So I trust that the Lord would be pleased and bless us together this morning as we look at additional thoughts and scriptures upon this very subject matter. I believe that the message of God's daily deliverance is a soul-cheering message to God's people to remind us and cause us to reflect upon and to appreciate and to praise and to have more of a heart, a seed of affection, of thanksgiving unto God for His daily benefits and blessings whereby He doth uphold us with the power of His right hand and takes care of us while we live here in this very troublesome world. I want you to notice here in verse 3 of 2 Corinthians chapter 1, in the apostle beginning here in introducing of these thoughts of God's past deliverance for him, of God's present day deliverances for the apostle Paul, and for the future great expectation, the expected end that the apostle has of God's furthering, delivering power. We believe this morning that God has delivered, that He is delivering, and He will yet deliver. And so we're thankful for that this morning. The apostle says in verse 3, "Blessed be God." This word blessed, that the translators translated this Greek word here and translated it blessed, it's used in many references in the New Testament to God our Father. Blessed be God. It's an expression of affection, of appreciation unto God. For you see, that's what's upon the apostle's heart and mind, and the stirring of the Spirit that he is about to go into and talk about from his experience, but that it's also the experiences of all of God's children of God's great delivering power. So why would he not say, "Blessed be God"? Amen. An expression of gratitude, an expression of thanksgiving, an expression of affection. Blessed be God. He is praising God. He has given an expression of thanksgiving and appreciation. Even the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Many times the apostle uses that expression concerning God, that He is the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. You know, today, when you use the word God in expression of a higher and great being, that is okay with most folks, for they use that in a general sense or in a generic way. But brothers and sisters, when you start to name the name of Jesus Christ, and you say Jesus is God, for we understand understanding know that Jesus is God. He's the second person of the divine Godhead of the Trinity. He is the Son of God, but He is God. He is deity. He and His Father, they are one. So God the Father, blessed be God, the Father of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I tell you, the apostle had much appreciation upon his heart and mind as he begins to write this second epistle to the church there at Corinth. We see it in the very language that he's giving out. And then he says of this blessed God, of this God that is the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, that he is the Father of mercies. We said just a few things concerning that. But I want to give you another text this morning, if you would. I'd like for you to turn with me back in the Old Testament there to the book of Micah. To the book of Micah and the very last verses. The closing verses, if you please, of Micah. And that would be there in chapter 7. In chapter 7 of Micah, starting for the sake of time in verse 18. And I'd like for you to notice these expressions here, talking about the mercies of God. Many places in the scriptures will refer us and teach us and talk to us about the mercies of God. I tell you this morning, brothers and sisters, that the mercy of God stems forth from the loving kindness of God. Oh, Jeremiah talked a lot about the loving kindness, and with the loving kindness he hath drawn us, and with loving kindness the Lord doth remember us. Notice what Micah said in 7 and 18. Who is a God like unto thee that pardoneth iniquity and passeth by the transgression of the remnant of his heritage? What does that, and passeth by the transgression? Does that mean that God just regards transgression, that God doesn't deal with transgression in a timely sense? No. But it's talking about the God, amen, that passes over for Christ's sake, whereby to house the elect in heaven in immortal glory because of the finished work of the Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, God is the great God of mercy. He pardons and he forgives iniquity, passeth by the transgression of the remnant of his heritage. He retaineth not his anger forever. Notice that. Ever he will not maintain his anger forever. Even though God deals in a chastising way with his people here in time, and even some instances, even to the point where it may be that some are chastened even to corporal death. But by and large, God's mercies are so great, whereby he turns again, and recovers one out of that situation and circumstance, even in a temporal sense. But we know that in that eternal sense, that every one of God's elect, no matter how far they stray, no matter what their plight in life has been, but yet God will deliver them on into the sunny banks of sweet deliverance, some wonderful day in heaven above, and immortal glory. And we do rejoice in that, brothers and sisters. It is the mercies of this blessed God that we do not get what we deserve, that we don't get what we deserve here in this life, and thank God that we won't get what we deserve in the world to come. Amen. That we will be delivered from an everlasting punishment because of the finished work of his dear Son that he gave in his love, his loving kindness, amen, out of the depths of his mercy, amen, to save a people for his namesake. and for his greatness and for his eternal purpose and pleasure that was purposed in him even before the very foundation of the world. So thank God that God has mercy upon us, that God gets us out of a lot of troubles. God gets us out of a lot of tribulations. God gets us out of a lot of snares, out of a lot of pitfalls, out of a lot of ditches, and rescues us and has mercy upon us. Thank God this morning for his mercy. Notice in verse 19, he will turn again. He will have compassion upon us. He will. Notice in just this short half of this verse that I've just read, we already have three he will. He will turn again. He will have compassion upon us. He will subdue our iniquities. He will subdue. He will overcome our iniquities. I don't know about you, but I'm glad of that. I'm thankful for that. I can't overcome. I can't subdue. Amen. I can't put under as though they were not my iniquities. But thank God, the blessed God, the Father of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the God of all grace and mercy, he can. And here, Micah the prophet said, he will. Amen. Thank God for these. He will. And thou wilt cast all their sins into the depths of the sea. Cast all their sins into the depths of the sea. This is what the God, amen, the blessed God, the Father of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and the God of all grace and mercy, amen, does for his people, to cast all our sins into the depths of the sea. Thou wilt perform the truth to Jacob. Notice that. Thou wilt perform. When you take that word and break it down, it simply means to give. How wonderful this is. Thou wilt perform, or thou wilt give the truth to Jacob, to the Lord's people. I tell you, amen. You see, Micah, hearing this is prophecy. He's talking about a time that will come. He's talking about God's delivering then and God's deliverance every day for his people, and also that eternal deliverance, the God that has and is and will yet deliver. But yet though, he talks about a giving of truth to Jacob. Thank God he has given the truth to the gospel church. Amen. His people, his Jacob, in the bounds of the gospel church. The church is the ground, the pillar of truth. Amen. The gospel church has the truth. Has, amen, the epitome of the truth. Has the truth, the way, the life, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. But I'm talking about the word of truth. Amen. The statements of truth. That which we have confidence in. That which we hold forth to. That which we understand. Amen. From God's word. Thank God is light and understanding in the gospel church. In the gospel kingdom, amen, there's light and there's understanding. Jesus is that light. We don't have need of the sun, amen, for the light. We have the S-O-N, Son, the Son of God is the light. Amen. The light of understanding. The light of truth. Amen. Where we can praise his name in an excellent way. Amen. Because we understand and know of this great truth in our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Let's turn back over there to 2 Corinthians there in chapter 1. So blessed be God, even the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and the God of all comfort, who comforteth us in all our tribulation, that we may be able to comfort them which are in any trouble. Oh, brothers and sisters, we are in trouble. We are in tribulations here in this life. Here in this time world, we are in tribulation. And because we go through these tribulations, because we have seen the delivering power of God and the keeping power of the mercy of God, then we're able to give aid. We're able to give help also to others that are facing tribulations, that are facing troubles here in this life. That would go along there with verse 10 and 11, who delivered us from so great a death, and doth deliver, in whom we trust that he will yet deliver us. Ye also helping together by prayer for us. By prayer for us. Remember, I told you last Sunday that verse 11 gives us the interpretation of the context of verse 10. How that the apostle is speaking in a timely sense of the delivering power of God. Yes, it is true. Amen. God in his purpose, even before the foundation of the world, purposed to deliver in that eternal sense of people from under the snare and the bondage and the sentence of death and trespass and sin. And then as his people comes along here in time to give them that vital deliverance, and then he will yet deliver them in glorification, that last change as we spoke of some weeks ago. But this is not the text to teach that. I believe the Apostle Paul, amen, is speaking of the temporal deliverances of God, the daily deliverances that pan out in our lives, because he said to these Corinthians that they were helping in these present deliverances by praying for the apostle. And we understand and know that heaven being populated is not dependent on whether we pray or not. Aren't you glad of that this morning? I'm thankful that God, having a people in heaven in mortal glory, I have nothing whatsoever to do with it, and that there is nothing encumbered upon me based upon my success or my failures, especially as a gospel minister. I feel to have so many failures so many times. I tell you, brethren, I don't believe probably there's any preacher worth his salt that's ever felt that he preached the perfect sermon, that he got every word right, that he got every text used that needed to be used and got it all right in the right sequence, in the right order, in the right context, and just nailed it right down the line. I doubt that anyone has ever actually failed to have accomplished that. So God's people being housed in heaven in mortal glory is not dependent on me or any other minister preaching the perfect discourse. Isn't that great? Isn't that a great relief? It is to me. And I tell you, amen, it's a great relief, because so many times we falter and we fail and we let things hinder us in our prayer life and in our meditation, in our calling upon the Lord. But that's not going to have anything to do with one being in heaven or one missing heaven and immortal glory. So when the apostle says concerning the church that they have helped in his deliverance, it's got to be right here in time. It's got to be right here in this life when they have helped in prayers and by putting legs on their prayers. You say, preacher, what do you mean by that? I remember the story told, a narrative concerning a family that lived next door to another family. And when this family that had groceries, when they had their meals and for they ate, how prayer and the father would pray, and in it he would ask the Lord to give the family next door groceries, to bless them and help them to have some food. The man was disabled, been out of work and so forth, and was down, needed help, but yet what he was doing, he was praying for him, but never going and helping and doing anything about it. And so that rocked on for a while, and as the narrative goes, one of the older daughters at the mealtime, and just right after her dad had prayed that prayer, she got up, and her dad said, "Where are you going?" She said, "I'm going to put some legs on your prayers." She began to gather up some groceries and put them in some bags. He said, "What are you doing?" She said, "I'm taking them to the family next door. We've been praying God to bless them and to give them some help and some groceries." Said, "I'm carrying them some." And that's what the apostle's talking about there in the end of verse 11. "Ye also helping together by prayer for us, that for the gift bestowed upon us by the means of many persons, thanks may be given by many on our behalf." The apostle says many have prayed and many have used their means to help us and to assist us. And he says, so therefore, thanks may be given by many on our behalf. He was thankful for God's children that were active and were doing the good works of faith, that were putting the legs and the hands to the things that they needed. Now, as I believe I said it last Sunday, and you've heard others, because so many times the nominal quote unquote religious world out here, they would just say, "Well, we're God's feet and we're God's hands," and leave it in an eternal sense. We know we're not God's feet and we're not God's hands, and God does not use men's legs. Amen. One place in the scripture tells us that. Amen. But it's talking about, amen, God's mighty deliverance for his people for heaven and immortal glory. But I want to tell you, brothers and sisters, I do believe God uses means here on the shores of time, and he uses our legs to go and our hands in service, to do service in the kingdom work of the Lord. We just have to keep things rightly divided and keep it in the right order, and know that it's not in order to, but it is because of. Amen. It is because of what the Lord has done for us, and because of our hope in glory, that we have an interest and a desire to be a benefit and help to others while we live right here on the very, very shores of time. Amen. Our help comes from the Lord. We don't need to look unto the hills. We don't need to look to the mountains. And that's in reference to where Israel had false gods upon every high place, upon every high place imaginable. Every lifted up geographical hill and mountain, they had idols, they had all of these things whereby that they were worshiping other than the true and the living God. Let me give, before we move on to in another vein of thought, I want to use a text that's found over in the Philippian letter, in Philippians 1 and verse 19, where he says in the Philippian letter, chapter 1, verse 19, "For I know that this shall turn to my salvation through your prayer and the supply of the Spirit of Jesus Christ." Now, if that don't prove my point concerning to what we've just been saying, "For I know that this shall turn my salvation through your prayer." It shall turn to my salvation through your prayer. In other words, the Apostle Paul was saying, there's a salvation that I'm going to have, talking about a deliverance, and it's in that context, back over there in 2 Corinthians chapter 1, of God's past deliverances, present deliverances, and God's future deliverances for the Apostle Paul while he lived here in this life. And he said, for I know that this shall turn to my salvation, to my deliverance through your prayer. He is saying right there that there is a deliverance that I'm enjoying through your prayers.
Amen.
Through your prayers. All right. And the supply. Oh, it's not vague prayers. It's not spiritless prayers. It's not without the aid of God.
No.
Oh, but he qualified that. It's through prayer and the supply of the Spirit of Jesus Christ. The Spirit of Jesus Christ. We understand from another expression in Scripture that the Holy Ghost is the Spirit of Christ. And it is the Holy Ghost, amen, that is the person, that is the agent, amen, of the ministry of God in the gospel kingdom. Amen, that Jesus said that he would pray the Father and the Father would send you another comforter. I won't leave you as orphans. Amen, I'll come unto you. He told them of the Holy Ghost that would come, that he would pray the Father. We know that was accomplished, and we know how the Spirit came on the day of Pentecost and abode with through the gifts and the blessings. We don't have the gifts and the manifold and to the degree and supply that the apostles and there in the early church, but we do have a measure. Amen. We have a measure, amen, of those gifts and helps by the Spirit. And this is what the apostle was saying. And the supply of the Spirit of Jesus Christ. I tell you, brethren, every time when you pray in earnest, when you pray by faith, when you pray in sincerity, and it's not just a passing, fleeting, out of duty type language of prayer, but from your very heart, a cry out to God, that you feel the dependency, that you feel the urgency of the need of the help, whether you're praying for yourself or for someone else. I'm going about that kind of prayer. I tell you, when that takes place, it will be aided. You will be aided by the Spirit of Jesus Christ. Oh, thank God forevermore and for the very truth of his precious word that teaches us these great and wonderful truths. Let us not think or to hold fast upon confidence in ourself or of ourself to know that our help, it doth indeed come from the Lord. Now, and so that reminds me of the verse that we all know and use from time to time, that Jonah, when Jonah had been was being delivered, when God was blessing him and delivering him out of that great fish, and as Jesus said, as Jonah was in the whale's belly 3 days and three nights, so Jesus said a whale, so I'm just going to say a whale there. Amen. When he was delivered out of that great fish, out of the belly of that whale, he said there in Jonah chapter 2 and verse 9, that last expression. Let's just read the whole verse. But I will sacrifice unto thee with the voice of thanksgiving. I will pay that I have vowed. Salvation is of the Lord. Now, most of the time, we use that expression, and I hear it used in conjunction when folks is using this expression in proving that God's salvation of his people for heaven, that it's of the Lord. Now, we know that God's salvation for heaven, immortal glory of his people, it's of the Lord. Amen. But what's Jonah just went through? What's just happened? And Jonah uses that expression. Jonah has just been delivered. Amen. He's just had a salvation, deliverance out of that belly of that great fish. So in the very context, amen, he's talking about a temporal deliverance, a deliverance that he has just experienced. And Brother Jonah said, this salvation, this deliverance, this has just happened to me, it's of the Lord. I tell you, if you'd been swallowed by, if you had ran, tried to run from the presence of God, and if you'd just been in a great storm, and you'd saw all that he had saw, and you'd been now in this great fish's belly, and you'd gone down into the very bottom of the mountains, there in the depths of the waters, and you were despairing of life and just knew that your life at any time was going to be over. There was nothing he could do. There was no way he could help himself. There was no getting out of that. I want to tell you, he was at the, you talk about somebody getting at the end of theirself. He was at the end of himself. He had done tied multiple knots on the end of the rope. Amen. Trying to hang on. Oh, but I tell you, his only help was looking to the Lord. His only help was acknowledging the Lord. His only help was repentance. His only help, was bowing unto the Lord, that he would go in a way of obedience. And so as the Lord, as he is right there about to being delivered, being set free and vomited out by that great fish upon dry land, he says, salvation is of the Lord. Deliverance is of the Lord. I've been delivered out of this belly of this big fish by the Lord. And brothers and sisters, I tell you that your deliverances, that you have from day to day, they are of the Lord. Amen. They're of the Lord. And they are from the Lord. What a great thought that is. There's also a verse in Psalms that goes right along with that. With that expression there in Psalm, the third Psalm, the last verse, verse 8. Psalm 3 and 8. Salvation belongeth unto the Lord. Thy blessing is upon thy people. Did you notice that? Salvation or deliverance belongeth unto the Lord. Salvation belongeth to the Lord, and salvation is of the Lord, is one and the same. The psalmist and old brother Jonah were saying the exact thing, that salvation is of the Lord. Salvation belongeth. Salvation or deliverance is the Lord's property. It's the Lord's. It's his. And it's his to measure out. It's his to give. Sometimes the Lord blesses in a way of obedience in accordance to his word for his children while we live here on the shores of time. But sometimes, amen, even when we have been neglectful, when we have been slack, when we have been in a lukewarm way, God is still God, and God is still great, and God doesn't stay angry at his people. And it's his, and it's his to give, and his to measure out. Oh yes. And so therefore, God gives it at his own pleasure. Salvation belongeth. Belongeth, E-T-H, belongeth. It's the Lord's possession. Salvation, deliverance is. Salvation belongeth unto the Lord. Thy blessing is upon thy people. Thank God for that this morning. That salvation belongeth to the Lord, and salvation is of the Lord. Even if we hewed the line, even if we pulled the plow straight, even if we didn't turn back or look back from the plow, when it's all said and done, brothers and sisters, we were still far as in the sight of a thrice holy and righteous God, we would be an unfit and unprofitable servant. Now that does not exclude or take away from all the things that God has admonished and given us in His Word and has committed Himself and obligated Himself. You can't obligate God, but God has obligated Himself by His very nature, amen, to perform based upon the promises and the blessings with those things that He has promised if we do them in a way of obedience. But we can't do them in and by and through our flesh nature. Amen. Anytime you obey the Lord, it's through your spirit nature. Yes. It's through your spirit man that is within you, that new creation. Because in yourself there's nothing good in my flesh. That's what the apostle said. There's nothing good in my flesh. Nothing good in me, not in my flesh. No, nothing good there. Amen. It's only that new creation that is there by the divine working of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Notice in Jeremiah chapter 3. In Jeremiah chapter 3. You know, we're going to see a word here. Backsliding. Moses and Jeremiah used this a good bit, backsliding, talking about it. God's people can slide back. God's people can drift away from the place where that they ought to be. And here, it had taken place with God's people. And so he says, "Return, you backsliding children," in verse 22 of Jeremiah chapter 3. "Return, you backsliding children, and I will heal your backslidings. Behold, we come unto thee, for thou art the Lord our God." That's important. "Truly in vain is salvation hoped for from the hills and from the multitude of mountains." Notice what he says. You backsliding children, you need to turn to the Lord and the Lord heal your backslidings, your backsliding ways. Because truly, in vain is salvation hoped for or expected from the hills and the mountains. I told you early what was on those hills and mountains. It was idol altars and idol gods that had been set up. Jeremiah is saying, in vain you are hoping, you are expecting for salvation from them. Oh, brothers and sisters, God's people, God is the only one that we need to look to and that we ought to look to for an expected deliverance. Don't look to the world for deliverance. No. Don't look to the world for help. You know, so many times the children of Israel, Hosea said this about them. Hosea said they're like a silly dove. They fluttereth back toward Egypt. What does that mean? That means that they look back toward Egypt like a silly dove, fluttering, expecting help or hope. What did they have in Egypt? They didn't have nothing but sorrow and misery. And it got worse and worse. And they never could make enough bricks for Pharaoh. I tell you, you'll never be able to make enough bricks for the old flesh in the world, this antichrist world system, even for those that profess the name of Christ, but lay out so many burdens and so many bindings and chains and fetters, trying put encumberments upon people that need help and deliverance and telling them do this and do that. You remember the man that wild Gadarene, if you please. He cried and cut himself and cried out in the tombs daily. They tried to tie him with fetters and chains, but he broke them. Their way of trying to help was trying to bind him. But the help he needed was loosening. He needed to be loose from what he was under. And that took the deliverance of the Lord Jesus Christ. Man couldn't deliver him, but the Lord could deliver him. And the Lord did deliver him. Thank God. Even that blind man that they told him to be quiet. But he cried out the more, "Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy upon me." Oh, how we need the more to cry out. This world says, oh, just hush down. Just don't. Y'all are fanaticals. Y'all are senile. Y'all are trusting in something you can't see. Well, what they have that they can see, that they can behold, they have something that maybe has that they've carved out, or something that they have imaginary, or something that they have made. But it cannot deliver them. I tell you, our God can and does and will deliver His people. Thank God for His delivering power.
Amen.
So truly, in vain is salvation hoped for from the hills and from the mountains, from the multitude of mountains. Truly, in the Lord our God is the salvation of Israel. Truly, in the Lord our God is the salvation of Israel. Israel's help, the Lord's children, our help, our deliverance is in the Lord.
Yeah.
You know, there's a beautiful proverb in Proverbs 21 and verse 31. Proverbs 21 and 31. Some months ago, the Jones family gave us a beautiful piece of wood, and these words are wrote on this piece of wood, and we have it hanging upon the wall. It's a beautiful piece of art that they took and made and so forth, and we appreciate it so much. And this is the verse. It says, "The horse is prepared against the day of battle, but safety is of the Lord." The horse. You know, there's a lot of folks, even God's children, that have got some horses.
Yeah.
They've got some horses that they're depending on. Their trust and hope is in that. I'm speaking symbolically. You understand that. I'm speaking metaphorically. But here, in this environment, in this economy, the horse was a strong and mighty animal. This was real. This is what they rode into battle upon. And upon a trained horse, a healthy horse, a strong horse. And the soldier would the rider would have confidence in the horse, that the horse would do what it had been trained to do and what it had been exercised to do and so forth. And their trust was in that animal. The horse is prepared against the day of the battle, against the day of battle. And brothers and sisters, I'm telling you this morning that we need to do preparations. We need to do the things the Scripture teaches us. We need to do what we can. But we don't put our trust in those doing of those things. We do them in faith, trusting that the Lord will take those things and bless them, and that He will give the strength and the help, and that He will give the deliverance. Remember, by the supply of the Spirit of Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
As our verse said back over there in Philippians. But folks that didn't trust in the Lord, folks that didn't have their confidence in the Lord, and so therefore the heathen went into the battles dependent upon those magnificent animals. With them up in a high area, place, away from the foot soldiers and up to where they would have advantage and so forth and on. But all the Scripture is teaching, the horse is prepared against the day of battle, but safety is of the Lord. You just remember, no matter how much you prepare your horse, the safety is of the Lord. The deliverance is of the Lord. The help, the expected help, is from the Lord. The Lord has to bless the means. Amen. For the means to work. Amen. For the means to be a help. For the means to be a blessing unto us. Let's just get a few more scriptures that would certainly go along with this. Over in Psalm 147. in verse, let's just go to verse 10 for the sake of time, the 147th Psalm. Verse 10. He delighteth not in the strength of the horse. He taketh not pleasure in the legs of a man. That's the verse that I alluded to earlier. The Lord taketh pleasure in them that fear Him, in those that hope in His mercy. There it is again, the Father of mercies. Our hope, our expected end is in the mercy of God. The Lord takes pleasure in His people fearing Him and hoping in His mercy. The Lord does not delight in the strength of our horse. Amen. The Lord doesn't delight in the strength of our horse that we might be so dependent upon. Now, yes, train that horse, exercise that horse, have a horse ready, do all of your preparation in accordance to what thus saith the Word of God. But you yet remember, though, that it's the Lord. You may sow and you may water, but it's the Lord that giveth the increase. Yeah. Remember that. It's the Lord that gives the increase. So, yes, we want to exercise our horse. We want to prepare our horse. But the safety is of the Lord. The help in the battle, it comes from the Lord. And here again He is saying, He delighteth not in the strength of the horse. He taketh not pleasure in the legs of a man. Yes, I tell you, God, you see, when we come to the end of ourselves, when we exhaust, God takes pleasure in coming to the rescue and in aiding and giving the deliverance and to show us that salvation is of the Lord. That salvation, that deliverance belongeth unto the Lord, and that He is exercising His property. Amen. Amen. He is exercising His means of great deliverance. In Psalm also, Psalm 33 and verse 16 starting. Psalm 33 starting in verse 16. I counsel you to encourage you to read verses above and below, even where we read, because we certainly don't have time during the course of the lessons. But notice in the Psalm 33, starting with 16, there is no king saved by the multitude of a host. A mighty man is not delivered by much strength. A horse is a vain thing for safety. Putting the trust in the horse. Putting trust in the means. Yes, we're to have means and time and use means. And Paul talked about their prayers and their help that he gave him as means. And he was in much appreciation and much thanks for those means. But remember that God is the God of deliverance. And that He's the one that delivers. Behold, the eye of the Lord is upon them that fear Him. There it is again. Upon them that hope in His mercy to deliver their soul from death and to keep them alive in famine. To keep them alive in famine. Our soul waited for the Lord. He is our help and our shield. For our heart shall rejoice in Him because we have trusted in His holy name. Let Thy mercy, O Lord, be upon us according as we have hoped in Thee.
Yeah.
One more along that particular line that's found in the Psalm, the 20th division. Psalm 20. Notice verse 7. Some trust in chariots and some in horses. But we will remember the name of the Lord our God. some trust in chariots and some in horses. Remember God delivering the children of Israel out of Egypt. Remember them coming up to the Red Sea. Remember how God brought forth that great and wonderful deliverance. But you remember in the midst of the sea, when God looked through the cloud and the pillar of fire and looked upon the Egyptians on the other side and saw them, you know, the cloud was in between them, the Egyptians and Pharaoh and the children of Israel that was on this side and going through upon dry shod. But the Lord gazed and looked upon them. And what did the Lord do? He took their chariot wheels off. The Lord took their wheels off. Yeah. Oh, Jay, you get to trusting in your chariot too much. The Lord take the wheels off, brothers and sisters. Yeah. The Lord take those wheels off, you're going to be stranded. You're going to be left on the side of the road when the wheels fall off. You know, that's an old saying I remember as a child using to express things. What you going to do when the wheels come off? You know, talking about when this thing fails, when this that you're doing, when the wheels run off of it, where are you going to be? Well, I want to tell you where they were. They were caught. They drove those chariots hard, the Bible says, but the Lord had took the wheels off. And they drowned, and when the children of Israel got safely on the other side, those big old walls that stood up of water like big old walls of concealed jello. Amen. God just melted them walls back down, and the water came in and drowned them. And Moses had told them by the voice of God, these Egyptians that you see today, you'll not see them anymore. Great Pharaoh, the Egyptians trusted in their chariots.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, you just read the language of it, and you read history back then upon it, and even on down through history, chariots, they trusted in them, they looked to them, their chariots, the heathen just nearly idolized them, and so forth, and the horses, and their great abilities for battle and all that, but God took the wheels off. And you know, I'm thankful. God knows how and when to take wheels off, but God can also put wheels on.
Yeah.
Isn't that wonderful? Amen. For God's people, God can put the wheels on. God can give us a ride. God can help us. I tell you, He can literally give you a ride. I can testify and witness to that. Amen. I rode over here in a vehicle that God, amen, provided. When there wasn't a way looked like, and a way was needed, God provided the way. I've seen the delivering power of God many times in life. I've seen the mighty workings of His hand. Oh, God is real. And thank God He's real in my soul right now. I feel Him real strong. Now in the morning it might be different, but right now I'm just going to rejoice a little bit in what I feel right now. Amen. And declaring unto you the mighty truth of God, that you can count on the Lord. You can trust in the Lord. Some trust in chariots. Some trust in horses. But we will remember the name of the Lord. We'll remember the Lord. We'll remember to call upon the Lord, to seek the Lord, and to seek Him right early, that He will come unto us and deliver us, amen, in a speedily way and manner. And what did He say in verse 8? Them that trust in chariots. Oh, they may trust in their horses, but we will remember the name of the Lord our God. They are brought down and fallen, but we are risen and stand upright. Save, Lord, let the King hear us when we call. Save, Lord, save. You know, that's what old brother Peter said.
Yeah.
You know, just when he was about to go beneath the waves, he just cried out, amen, for deliverance. Save me, Lord. Save me. Save us. Oh, sometimes, you know, a lot of folks, you know, especially in so many places, just think anytime you see the word save or salvation, you know, it's just talking about being saved in heaven, mortal glory. I want to tell you, brothers and sisters, that I'm going to say, give or take a little bit, but just to show you how much, I'm going to say 80%. I don't believe I'll be far off, and it may even be a lot more than that. The times that you see the word save or saved or salvation in the Bible, it's talking about right here. Amen. And right now, in this very time world. Thank God there is a deliverance into heaven's pure world. There is an entrance that has been made through the Lord Jesus Christ, whereby all of God's elect children will be saved and be present and accounted for without the loss of one. But I'm thankful because we live right here in the now and now. I've been living in the now and now for some 60 years. And I tell you, I want to say it's the Apostle Paul, having obtained help of the Lord, I continue until this day. I continue until now. Oh, because of having obtained help from the Lord. You have continued up into this point because you've had help from the Lord. You haven't done it on your own. I want to tell you, no matter what anyone thinks, no matter how smart they may think, no matter how intelligent, no matter how planning and so forth, that a person may think that they are, but we must have the miraculous, marvelous, delivering power of God. Oh, while we live right here in this life. And thank God for it. Thank God for His delivering power. I trust this morning that these further thoughts upon this subject matter would be of great blessing and encouragement to you. We'll stand together. We'll publish the open door of the church.